Yes, it is. And now we'll have talk by Irina Aref'eva on Cauchy problem for non-local equations. And you have half an hour, please. Can you unmute yourself?
I'm sorry.
Yes, this is better. Thank you.
And it's okay now? Okay.
Yes, can you repeat maybe the title or whatever you said?
On the okay, first? Okay. Sorry. Sorry. It is my pleasure to give a talk at this conference. The title of the talk is Cauchy Problem for Non-Local Equation. I would like thanks, organizer, for invitation. And especially, I would like to mention that I was asked by organizer to speak on this particular problem. In fact, my last paper on the subject was written about 10 years ago, but I try to tell you what I remember. Okay. The title of my, I'm sorry, outlook of my talk will be the following. I will start from reminder some paper on non-locality in quantum field theory starting from 50s. Then I will discuss non-local equation of motion as pseudo-differential equation. We will see the difference between this equation for two different cases when we deal on whole plane or we deal with half plane. And I will pay special attention for exponential non-locality and diffusion equation. This type of non-locality appear in string field theory. I guess you get some taste or flavor, as you like, about string field theory from previous Ashok talk. And then I will mention about some peculiarity which appears for non-local oscillator on half line. And in the end, I will a little bit mention about about some physical consequences on of this mathematical subsurface. So let me remind about this, some of this paper. First of all, I would like to remember you that there was a Yukawa paper written in 1949, in which he deal with bilocal field, which in some sense predecessor of string field theory. So there are two variables here. Also, I would like to mention the important paper by Pius Uhlenbeck. And here, just for the case, I presented couple paper of Russian scientist, because I guess it is not very well known for out of our country audience. There are, of course, many, there was a big activity of this subject, in especially in the middle of a previous century. And the main motivations to discuss non-locality in that time is the same as in our days, just to eliminate divergences. And I will speak not about all this activity. I will speak about some particular non-locality related with string field theory. String field theory, this is some approach to string where we can study some non-perturbative phenomena. And string, we all some of us believe that there is no ultraviolet divergences at all in strings. So this is a good opportunity for us to look how the absence of divergences can work in usual case. What is a more important property of string theory to remove divergences? In my presentations, of course, I cannot cover whole the subject, and I discuss some particular phenomena. And here is a list of papers which are important for my consideration. One of the starting point is a paper by Zwiebich and Müller, where they discuss dynamic with infinite number of derivatives, and they discuss this dynamic especially for non-locality, for non-local model related with bosonic string theory. Also, there are several papers where people discuss the subject for bosonic strings and as well as the more complicated stuff. For me, I will follow today mainly on this paper, which we wrote with Igor Valovich about 10 years ago. And there is also a big list here. I apologize if I don't mention all other people who are now in the audience. Okay, let me present you the simplest action related with string field theory, more precisely related with string field theory. In fact, more precisely related with cubic version of string field theory. Cubic version of string field theory, open string field theory in flat background was constructed independently in these two papers. And if we consider this model, including Gasuo minus sector, then in framework of level truncation, the action which describe the low level fields is presented here. Here, phi is a tachyon field and u is auxiliary field. This auxiliary field has no kinetic term. This tachyon field has a kinetic term as well as a massive term. This is in fact negative mass. And there is some particular interaction. This is nothing as a cubic interaction, but here there is important sign. This is a tilde. This tilde, please don't confuse this tilde with Fourier transform. In fact, during my talk, I will also use this tilde for Fourier transform. But now this tilde means that I deal with a field which can be obtained by acting on this non-local operator on the initial field phi. Okay, everything is clear. And since this field is auxiliary, we can integrate it out this field, and we end up after this with this result. You see here, phi tilde, then we calculate the square of this phi tilde, which is a square. After that, we apply once again the action of this operator to this object and take the square and take the second power. Then We can try to study equation of motion, which follows from this, from previous, I'm sorry, maybe I will show once again, which follows from this Lagrangian. There is no big problem to study this equation of motion, especially solution, which depends only on time. So this is special independent solution of homogeneous in special homogeneous solution. And to study this equation of motion analytically, it is very convenient to introduce ad hoc, but there are some, we can check this assumption numerically. And according to this assumption, what we do, we just erase tilde from this term, just by hand. And we can see what we get. After we perform integration, now the answer is very simple. We have the quartic power of phi tilde. So this is a counterpart of bosonic case. In bosonic case, there is the power of third power instead of fourth power. And after scaling, we left with this approximate action. And we can study equation of motion. The equation of motion can be written from this action. And after further definition, we get the following equation of motion. So we get non-trivial, non-local kinetic term. This is a, here is written a standard kinetic term, and here is this non-local, and this is a cubic interaction. So we can proceed and study this equation of motion. But let me stop here and discuss some mathematical subtleties which appear just at this point. And we try, I will try to convince you that here we get some mathematical subtleties, but these mathematical subtleties can give us some interesting physical, new physical interpretation. These subtleties are related with our understanding of this non-local operator, especially in particular case when we deal with the exponent. Usually, as a mathematical literature, we can understand the function on derivative using the Fourier transform or Laplace transform. And these both cases, generally speaking, can be applied for relatively good function phi. I will tell you, just for analytical function, we can we can have in mind. But in this particular case, when we deal with exponent, there is one more possibility. We can use Fock representation, or so-called diffusion equation, and let's see what we get. First, I mentioned Fourier transform. In this case, the action of this operator is presented here. And Fourier transform work very well when we deal with infinite interval, when we deal with time goes from minus infinity to infinity. Now I speak only on space homogeneous configuration. If we deal with only with positive time, then we have changed our notation and use Laplacian transformation. And how to define the action of derivative in the case when we deal with positive, when we deal with half plane, it is very well known. We just can take any textbook on complex complex analysis and find a formula which is presented here. This formula has a meaning under some special assumption. Please, so I prefer not to go to this detail, just I would like to skip. This is important, but let me skip them. So we can apply this procedure for exponents. So in the case with exponent and see what happens. And we call this operator, which we get. This is by definition, we define the action of this object on the function five by right hand side. We put here subscript L, which means Laplace. So using Laplace transformation, we get a precise precise definition written here. There is also possibility to use here more general stuff. Instead of derivative, take arbitrary constant. In this case, we get a more general Laplacian general definition, and you can find such kind of definition in mathematical literature. Also, we can, for particular for exponent, we can use a Fock representation, which means the following. To give a mathematical meaning to this operator, one can use auxiliary function of two variables psi. Psi depends on tau and t. And solve the following equation. This is a Cauchy diffusion equation with this initial condition. It is very well known from mathematical literature that in the case when we deal with whole axis, when t goes from minus infinity to infinity, this problem has a unique solution, and we can define this operator as a solution of this system, of this initial problem for tau equal to one. But situations change drastically when we deal with half line. In this case, you will see what we get. And just here, I would like to mention that from the cosmological perspective, there is a reason to consider the case t more than zero, because we know that in Friedman cosmology, there are cosmological singularity at t equal to zero. So there is a reason to consider the case only t more than zero. Yes. And in this case, instead to specify this initial condition, we have specified some extra condition. We have to put a mixed initial boundary value problem. There are different types of this problem. In particular, if we specify the value of this function of two variables at t equal to zero, then we call this problem a Dirichlet problem. In fact, we use here the name Dirichlet-Dimon, and I will explain later why we use the word Dimon. And so we can maybe already guess, but Dimon, this is some guy who can run the universe, make some unpredictable things. And I would like to say that if we consider more complicated example, something related with non-flat geometry, this and consider a similar problem with initial condition, this Dirichlet condition can drastically change all possible solution. Okay, and There is a theorem that that claim if we fixed this mixed initial and boundary problem with we fixed this function and we fixed that one, then this system has unique solution, and so this solution can be represented in the following integral form. What we can say now, we can define the action of this operator. This action now has subscript D, this is Dirichlet, mu, we specified this function, and this right-hand side has the following integral representation. You see that here enter this function, this Dimon function mu. Question. Before this big question, let me just say that where this action of this operator can be presented as a sum of two terms. The first term corresponds to zero boundary condition, and the second term is nothing but some source which has this representation. Now we can also consider the Neyman case, which deal with a derivative here, but let me skip this stuff. So let me just summarize what we have. I mentioned that to define this operator, we can use Fourier or Laplace transform, or we can use heat kernel method. So the question is now which is natural to rise, what is the relation between Dirichlet method and the Laplacian transform method? So because they look a little bit different. In the Laplacian method, there is no ambiguity at all. And in Dirichlet method, we have to specify some extra arbitrary extra function mu. And the main point of my talk is a proposition which look like is written here. According to this proposition, the Laplacian action of this exponential operator can be presented as a special case of Dirichlet operator. And in this special case, the new function which specifies the action is given by the following integral representation. This is relatively, it's not complicated, but still you have to write Kappa formula to explain this presentation. What is written here? You see that here enter var phi. And in the right-hand side, we see a usual phi. And the relation between this function is written here. We have to consider Taylor series. And instead of factorial here, we have to write explicitly a half of this factorial. And once again, this formula, I rewrite once again this formula. It's written here. So let's me, how much time? Still, I still have 10 minutes.
Yes, so, you have some 7-10 minutes. You have, yes.
How much?
Well, about 10 seven. Yes. Let's say 10, yeah.
Yes.
Oh, let's say 10.
Yes. So the proposition state that Laplace Dimon is a particular case of a Dirichlet Dimon with a special Dirichlet function. Now let's try to use this to solve some physical problem. Because we have some kinetic operator, in our case, we have in our disposal non-local kinetic operator. So the first task we have tried to understand is how to look this non-local version of oscillator. So let's consider the simplest equation of motion, which is written here. We take here Dimon with with zero initial function, and here we are some mass two. If we perform expansion of this exponent, and then we get this equation. This is nothing but a very well-known oscillator. And you see that when m is less than one and tau more than zero, then you get a good oscillator, the usual oscillator. If m is more than one, then we get a tachyon. And now we, this is the first remark, and of course we have to now to find solution of this equation. And here it is, I rewrite here the integral form of this equation. So according to our definition, this non-local term can be presented in the integral form. So this is everything is absolutely clear. Everything is written explicitly. So we have find solution of this integral equation for t more than zero. Okay. The solution of this equation, rewrite this equation, is presented here. What we have here? We have infinite number of terms. This is this term is an odd function, and you see also this is a real function. And this alpha n are the subject of the following correlation. If we perform expansion up to the first non-trivial term, we get, instead of this equation, we get this one, and we have this answer. Okay. So let me show solution for zero mode. I'm sorry. Here, when n equals to zero, we call this zero mode. There is no this term here. So if m more than one, then we have here a real solution, which could exactly correspond with the tachyon. There is no oscillation. To get oscillation, we need to have here negative term. If we have negative term, this is minus here, so we get oscillations. And for as n equals zero, we have no oscillation. And let me show that in this case, we have this solution. What we have to check? We have to check that the action of this operator on this particular function, hyperbolic sine, is equal to this term. It took formally it took okay, no problem. Formally is this is obvious for this is obvious formula, but let's check this using our definition. And you will see that this is not so trivial, and this is not so trivial, because formally you can just take one exponent here, not buff, you can consider not necessarily two terms which presented in a sign, but you can take just one exponent and get that you construct the solution. But this is not true, because we have to deal with exact definition, and according to exact definition of this symbol with D and zero here written here, we have to take this kernel and act by this kernel to this function. And it is, now we can explicitly calculations give you R function. And of course, this is not what you start with, because you start only with this term, and here you see a lot of different term. And it is the point is that if you take here my e in power minus, so then you get this result, and to cancel all this ERF, you have to take a difference between two terms. This is exactly what is written here, and you see that there is a cancellation, and you see immediately that we get finally this answer. Okay. It is amusing, it is amusing that we can calculate the energy pressure on this solution, and you get the following answer. And if m square is more than one, then energy is negative, what it should be for tachyon, then m square less than one, then less than one, there is a minus here, you get positive energy. And energy is conserved, it does not depend on time, but pressure depends on time. And it is interesting that this combination that in Friedman case define a Haber parameter is always positive when m square is less than, this combination is positive when m square less than one. Okay, now we finished with harmonic oscillator, non-local harmonic, I would say non-local harmonic oscillator. And then we can consider the harmonic oscillator, not harmonic oscillator, but harmonic oscillator with some current. It is not so simple to solve this problem. No, of course, any formula are very explicitly, but it is not just 1 minute problem, but to solve this problem for arbitrary current, but for some particular current, we can find solution. And to get the solution, it is useful to remember to take into account the following property. Acting by this operator on some constant, you get this answer. Okay. Yes, I almost go to the final two transparencies. So let me give a summary from mathematical part. I have shown that repression Dimon is a particular case of Dirichlet Dimon with special boundary, boundary function. We have found a non-local solution for Dirichlet non-local oscillator. And we discussed a little bit solution with for arbitrary function. And let me instead to tell you some physical application of to cosmology, because it would be many, it would be as a several talk. I just would like to show you the list where such kind of kinetic operator, or better to say generalization of this non-local kinetic operator was used in cosmology. First, I would like to start from my paper, where I consider it a non-local string as a model for cosmological dark energy. Then there are several paper on the subject, that there are also application not only for later cosmology, but application for inflation. And as I already said, in my presentation, I mainly used our paper with Igor, written entitled Cosmological Demon. And there are, of course, many other activity on the subject where people use non-local, I would say, string field inspired cosmology, and also that generalized with for more complicated case, and also not only for matter, nonlocality for matter, but also nonlocality in gravity. And I think you will see a lot of stuff and a lot of information about all this stuff in the next talk by Branka Dragovic. So, this is the end of the talk. Thank you very much. And I would like just mention that I put also some backup, very long backup, which contain the proof of proposition one. Who are interested can look on my transparencies, which I guess will be collected in the conference site. Okay, thank you very much once again.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. So we have a lot of questions. So let's start with a question by Terry Tumbulis.
I'm sorry, can I see all this question?
No, I just people raising hands, so they will be talking now.
Okay.
So Terry, can you please?
Yes, thank you. My question is, maybe I missed something, but it's the very starting point. You start with a non-local theory, and then you say you are going to consider the Cauchy problem. Now, that doesn't appear to make sense. The equations of motion for a non-local theory are integral differential equations. There is a huge mathematical literature on that. They're called equations with delays. There is no well-defined Cauchy problem. You cannot specify data at a given instant, only over a whole range of points.
I understand your question. Okay. Very much for your questions. I spoke mainly for diffusion equation, mainly for some special form of non-locality. And fortunately for us, for non-diffusion, for a diffusion equation, we can we have a well-posed Cauchy problem, but we have to specify also the boundary condition. In more complicated cases, of course, there is very huge mathematical literature. You can find some of more important paper in the reference list of my Igor paper. So thank you once again. For more general case is difficult problem. For some particular case, especially for whole line or half line. This is a very well known mathematical subject, and I use it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Okay, so a question from Fabio. Fabio, can you unmute yourself?
Yeah, thank you very much for the talk. So my question was very much related to that of Terry. So as far as I understand, you basically consider linear equations and you apply, let's say, Fourier transform and Green technique. So that's everything works pretty well with linear equations, but in that case, you can just cancel the nonlocality just by field redefinition. So what happens with nonlinearities?
Oh yes, thank you.
For nonlinear equations, you use usually solitonic techniques. So I wonder if there is some generalization of these techniques to nonlocality.
Thank you very much for your talk, for your questions. I spoke here only on about simplest linear case, but there is a rich literature where people discussed also mathematical literature where people discuss non-linear version of this equation. In particular case, there is a paper by mathematician Vladimirov and also Baloich paper where they discuss a particular example quartic interaction, and they found some special solution.
Yeah, but in special, especially in relation to solitonic techniques, there is something already done there, or
no? There are some theorems. They prove the existence theory if we take a special boundary condition. Of course, there is no full construction of all possible solution, but there are some special example, and so we can say that in some particular cases, the existence theorem approved. Yes. We use the okay. We use some technique to prove the solution. Yes.
Okay. So can we move to the next question? Maybe it was one question from Valery Frolov.
Hi, Ira. Very nice talk. But I have a question. You started at the beginning with the operators which are exponent of box. But most of your talk, you were speaking about operator exponent of a second derivative of time. So you use eigenvalues for this operator, but when you consider box operator, eigenvalues are different. They have no properties that they're positive definite. So what happens if you consider your approach applied to the exponent of box operator? I can expect that if you guarantee that it will be good behavior for large time, it will be bad behavior at large distances. How you solve this problem?
It's true. I don't solve this problem. I spoke mainly about time-dependent solutions. So this problem is not so simple. We have to study, to do a lot. So to be honest, I discussed only solution which depends on time.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, and maybe one final question from Richard Woodard. Can you unmute yourself, please?
Thank you. Thanks for the nice talk, Irina. I think this is very much the same issue that Terry mentioned, and that is one thing that troubles me about these models involving e to the second derivative squared or e to even a first derivative. Is that if I write them in terms of a integral kernel, they involve knowledge of the fields arbitrarily far in the future. And although it's definitely not the case that an arbitrary field configuration solves the equation, it does seem like I get to just specify for free the value of the field for some finite amount of time. in the future for some, you know, I could specify it arbitrarily for some finite amount of time. And no matter what I specify, I can always make it solve the equation by then changing appropriately what happens later on in the future. Is that somehow not the case for what you're considering? And if not, why not?
I would like to say what I presented, what is we can present. So I cannot tell you on all possible answer to all possible questions, because in fact, I agree that it is very difficult to define the action of arbitrary of operate of mathematically rigorously the action of function of operator, especially in the case when we deal, for example, with the Lambertian operator.
Irina, if I might interject, I'm not quarreling about the definition. I'm happy with the integral kernel that you provided for the definition. It's the consequences of the equation that trouble me, and I think that was also the issue that Terry was worried about. It seems very much, if you just look at that, that I get to just specify for free the value of the field for any finite amount of time, and I can always then choose the behavior of the field later on in time to make it solve the equation. That indicates that there's just a huge amount of data that needs to be specified to get the general solution.
I agree that this is not, we have to specify infinite number of derivatives. So I wrote only what we can write. We cannot just mimic the standard procedure with a finite number of derivatives. Sometime for some theory, we can make so-called localization, but this is not the case for exponential, because for an exponential, in some sense, this exceptional case. So, if you say, let me show you this. We can just solve this equation. So we call this initial data, and we call this some Dimon function. This is Dimon function, but nothing more. So we get here some extra function, not a finite number of some constant, but the whole function. So if I have some more complicated boundary condition, or I can, for example, take a Neyman boundary condition, I will get some other integral representation. So in some sense, the Cauchy problem, this is a name. So I use this just to take attention to this problem. Better to say that we deal with initial boundary value problem. From a mathematical point of view, we have to say we deal with initial boundary value problem. We specify this function at this is auxiliary parameter equals to zero, and at t equals to zero, we get some extra function. This is, we do not have this extra function when we deal, for example, with Fourier transform, when we deal with whole whole line. So this is a very untypical, very, very untypical situation as compared with usual quantum usual with usual scalar field theory, which we after that we can quantize. So better to say that we deal with initial boundary problem here, and only in the Cauchy, only in the case when we deal with whole line, we can say that it's enough to know this initial condition. We can say, okay, this is initial function, some kind of Cauchy initial. We can call this function as a Cauchy initial function, but this is up to you. So better to just say this is an initial condition. And due to this subtlety, it is not so simple to solve, for example, oscillator with extra current. Usually when we—
I have a proposition here. Maybe we can postpone a longer answer for the discussion session.
Okay,
Because indeed we have two more talks and we are running quite out of time. So thank you very much for your nice talk, which caused a lot of interest.